Good evening, everyone. It is 5:11. Time to start. First of all, I would like to thank ELPA, Earthing and Lightning Professional Alliance. And I would like to thank everyone who has joined my group, Igniting Power Engineers. We have created a tribe of like-minded people where we will be able to share our knowledge. We will be able to separate knowledge, whatever little bit everyone has, and everyone will have to come out with their session to disseminate the knowledge. It's not my group, it is our group. I have said that thing many times in the group also. And there are two things in my life, in every life, crying and trying. When you are crying about something, you lose your confidence. When you are trying, it builds your confidence. And that is never-ending process. Just keep on trying and learning. This is the objective of this group. And I am happy the people across Pan-India have joined that group. They will definitely come out with their new thought, with new kind of theory, new kind of experiment, new kind of R&D to make my India the best nation in the world. And I will be failing in my duty if I don't mention some names. First of all, I would like to thank Almighty, my parents, my family, Bhai Saab, Patnaik Saab, Nihar Ji, Sridhar Saab, Sanjeev Banerjee, Vikas Sir, Dr. IPS Paul, respected Ramachandran Sir, respected Anjuli Chandra Ma'am, KK Murthy Ji, Raja Mani Saab. I am here because of blessings and guidance of all these things. Last but not the least, my respected S. Abhav Sir, who just accepted our invitation to give his very first presentation on this forum. Thank you very much, sir. Now, stage is yours, and we are ready to rock. Over to Abhav Sir. Please start, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Rajesh Ji. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay. Let me first open my screen and please ensure that whether it is visible. Is it visible? My screen.
Yes, go to the presentation mode, sir.
Is it visible first? Let me know whether the presentation slide is visible.
Yes, it is visible, sir.
Okay, fine. Very good evening, everybody. I should first thank the organizer, Earthing and Lightning Protection Alliance, and especially my special thanks goes to Sri Dr. Rajesh Ji, who is having an untiring effort. He's very active. I can't believe how he is doing so much of work in addition to his normal office duties. Anyhow, I should thank him. And I should thank all these stalwarts in this group. Also, my thanks goes to Dr. Vikas Shalmadi. So I would like to start my presentation. The thing is, there is some glitches in my video, in my computer video, and there is some glitches, and you will be missing my face. Anyhow, let me give my audio effects only in my whole presentations.
No issue. If any participants have any queries, they can write down their queries in the chat box. At the end of the session, we will try to answer all the queries. In case we are not able to answer because of scarcity of time, that will be definitely answered in the group or through email. You can write down your questions during presentation in the chat box. I am here to note it down. And we will finish our presentation by 5:55. Then we will go for the question answer for 15 minutes, and we will be stopping by 6:11 sharp.
Okay, once again, very good evening, everybody. First of all, the topic of this session, this webinar session, is earthing practices for LV system and sensitive electronic equipment. The thing is that we are we should have our own safety first. Let me start from the home. So it's better always to start from the home and have ourselves safeguarded against any electrical hazard, as well as I will be addressing the issues of some sensitive equipments, because it also occupies an essential space in our daily life. And of course, my presentation will be based on the references of IS 732, IS 3043 for earthing, and IEEE 142 and IEEE 1100. So why the associated factors will also be dealt with, like coordination between the fault clearing device, cable, and load. My topic will be limited to the earthing practices alone, but some associated factors like this will also come then and there. Then we have to design. Actually, the design of earth electrode, etc., will not be discussed here, because we are going to follow the TNS system. In both the LV system as well as the sensitive electronic equipment, we are concerned with TNS system only. So the fault current will naturally flow directly. It will bridge the protective equipment conductor, will bridge the neutral earth electrode, the earth flat, and very meager amount of earth current will be circulating between the affected person and the general mass of earth. Then it will reach the neutral earth electrode and then to the source. So the main portion will be through the protective earth conductor only. So the question of earthing design, everything, it will take and it will be covered in some other SV and other TT system of earthing and other earth installations. Now we will be restricting our topic to the TNS system alone, as well as the mitigation of noise on electronic as well as sensitive devices. Our focus will be on, naturally will be on earth fault loop impedance, as well as the sizing of conductors of our LT installations, so that the protective equipment conductor should withstand the fault current. That a small portion will also appear in my slides. Now I will go straight away to slides one by one. Why I am saying that I am restricting to TNS system is, our subject, the present topic, is limited to that. As also, it will become an elaborate one if you go for the earthing design, earth electrode configurations, and other things that will go, that will be covered on another subject. Naturally, in most of the countries, say whether US or some European countries, they follow TNS system, and in Japan they follow TT system. In certain part of the world, say for example Norway, they follow IT system, that is unearthed system. But in Germany, as per VDE standard, they insist unearthed system for critical loads. In hospital installation also, IEC says that we have to go for unearthed system, that is IT system. So it is not, it's not a hard and fast rule to go for this type of system only, this type of system only. It can vary. There can be several type of system within the same installation. So there is no hard and fast rule. I again want to insist that. So as far as IT equipments, IT, that is information technology equipments and sensitive devices are concerned, we are dealing with the methodology of connections. Not concentrating on the earth electrodes, the methodology of connections only will be saying. So as far as the LT installations and the households are concerned, you first ensure whether we have violated or we are intruding in the distribution company's already constructed line, or whether they are intruding our constructed house. Both are equally responsible. You have every right as per CEA regulations 60 and 61. These are the clearances stipulated. And as far as say earthing is concerned, this is a source, and we have load also, and this is the conductor. This protective equipment conductor earthing made between the equipment and the neutral earth flat. Then comes the neutral earthing. Here you can see whenever a fault occurs, most of the fault current flows through the protective equipment conductor through the source. This is the fault loop. This is the source, this is the fault, and protective earthing. Some minor part alone will come through the general mass of earth. This is a TINS system. And we also have earthing of lightning protection system, and we have earthing of building rebar earthing. Then the equipotential bonding, it is an essential. This is mandatory that we should provide an equipotential bonding that connects all these extraneous voltages that can come from lightning or some other ESD discharges. So these things have to be taken care. They will also be connected. And this is the important criteria. This is mandatory. Whatever the type of system you have, you should have an equipotential bonding in your building to protect you from the effects of extraneous voltages. And as far as computer installations or sensitive devices are concerned, we have lot of methodologies. One of such methodology is the insulated conductor. I will explain the insulated conductor from the sensitive equipment device so that it will not get any noise from the adjoining metallic part. It can be connected directly to the source neutral. And we also have for the high frequency, we especially have a signal reference grounding. So these are the things that I will be addressing in this webinar. And if you simultaneously, if a person happen to touch a leaky or faulty metallic part of any appliance, some fault is fault will flow through is so this can flow in various ways. One through the building rebar air, and it can be flow through the equipotential bonding conductor. Then it's also possible to have a fault current path to the source towards the neutral earth electrode. So the major, I this is an important slide. Why I am elaborating in this slide is, you should remember in a TNS system, the neutral is connected. I will show it in another sketch also about the TNS system. The protective equipment is connected to the neutral, thereby your fault will be shunted through the protective equipment to the source. Only a remaining smaller portion will be passing through the person, and some portion will be passing through the additional equipotential bonding conductor. Simultaneously, these arrangements will safeguard the insulation from lightning surges also. So what are the factors that can influence for the safety of an insulation? We should have a coordination between the protective gear, load and conductor, especially the size and the length. Then the I2T, the I2T of a phase conductor, it should be higher than the I2T of the fault clearing device. Another thing is the I2T, the fault clearing device should ensure operation depending upon the type of load. You may have your high starting current load will always be there in your home, like your home or some small LT installations. There will be some slurry pump or that some load that can start with the load itself. So in that cases, you have to select the FCBs, the protective fault clearing device that can withstand during the insurge current required for the start. So we have to select the short time current as demanded by the typical load. Otherwise, we should be safe, but we should use all the equipments also. That's a thing that this is a requisite for which only we are these are associated factors. We can arrive everything and use the equipment also. Then this is another important factor. The possible lead through current a human body can satisfactorily conduct is 29 milliamps per 5 seconds. This is as per IS. And there is one more compliance for the wet condition. The lead through current should be 23 milliamps per 5 seconds. These are all the factors that is influencing the safety of an installation for which we have to devise the earthing system accordingly. See, this is the thing that we all know. This is the design current. This is the important two parameters as per IEC, that the protection against overload, we have to coordinate the load current IB. We have to design cable. The rated current of the cable should be naturally higher than the design current of the load that we have. And I is the current carrying capacity of the cable. This is a rated protective device. This is a rated current of the protective device. So the first and foremost thing is design current should be less than the protective device rated current, and it should in turn be less than or equal to the current carry capacity of the cable. Here comes the second part, where the current ensuring operation, that is the if for example we have an MCB curve also, I will give you in the next slide, that normally cables are designed to withstand 1.45 times of the rated current for a period of 1 hour. Accordingly, there are MCBs that can go below this rating also. That's why it is insisted that rating of current ensuring effective operation of the MCB should be less than the 1.45 times of the cable, so that the cable is protected. This is a typical curve of an MCB that has to be used. For example, this is the first portion. This is, see, you can see at 1.13 times, this is a non-tripping curve. So at 1.13, it will start. At 1.45, this is a fault, it will clear the fault. So 1.45 is a fault ensuring operation of the MCB. Some MCBs have still some K-type, other MCBs are in picture. So we have to ensure 1.45. There are some MCBs of which can withstand a higher starting load also. Some MCBs that can trip at 3 to 5 times. Some D-type MCB can take 10 times the load to withstand the starting current, depending upon the load you use. So whatever the type of MCBs or fault clearing device, we have to ensure the earthing system should be in a manner that no compromise is made and person is not affected. And this is one more important factor. The I square T of the lead-through energy in a cable should always be more than the lead-through energy of a protective device. Simultaneously, we have to ensure in a domestic installation how many conduits. The purpose is we can't expect the owner of a domestic premises or small HA installations to be conversant with all those things, but they can insist their electrician or the technician, the contractor, whether they are doing the right thing. And this voltage drop that has to be taken care while installing the cable. So these are the things which are not related to the earthing practices. However, the earthing practices is interrelated to these things also. Without this, merely providing safe earth practices and not using the equipment is of no use. So now I am coming to the purpose of earthing. So we have to provide a low impedance earth fault return path to clear the earth fault and achieve protection. So it is vague, low impedance. What should be the impedance we should have? These are the things that we will need. Then limit the step and touch voltages. Then minimize the effect of lightning strike on personal equipment and structures. Finally, the minimize electrical noise interference in control and instrumentation system. So first thing, low enough impedance and the electrical noise will be concentrating. Stepper test potential will come for the substation and ST insulation. Lightning strike and personal equipment will also form a separate part. So we'll be concentrating first on the final part only. So this is the provision of CEA regulations, which insists that supplier shall provide and maintain in the consumer premises a suitable earthed terminal. Another thing, in case of installation of voltage exceeding 250 volts, the consumer shall also provide. So there are two sides. If a consumer is having a connection, a small dwelling house, a single phase service having connected voltage of 250 volt, less than 250, then the supplier shall provide. This is a thing, this is a right, the consumer has the right to insist the supplier to provide, while remitting the charges, development charges or service connection charges, this cost should also be borne by the consumer, so that supplier shall provide. Then, provided further that the supplier may not provide any earthed terminal in the installation if it is already connected, up to what time on or before the date to be specified by the state government. Or the supplier, if the supplier is satisfied, the consumer's earthing arrangement is sufficient. So the whole responsibility, you can say, see that it is resting with the supplier as well as the government. Of course, consumer is also responsible, but the main responsibility goes with the supplier as well as the government. Government has to provide some ultimatum. Otherwise, the utility, the the distribution company shall satisfy whether the earthing electrode is required or not, or their earthing system is sufficient. Then, this is another important thing. Whatever the type of earthing, as I have told, this is the provision as per Regulation 41 that you should provide an equipotential bonding. This equipotential bonding is a must. For example, a panel board. Some people may try to insulate a panel board. I have seen some inspection. They have insulated a distribution board. Actually, you can't provide an insulation. High frequency, everything is capacitively coupled to the ground reference. And there will be a noise between the electronic loaded equipment in view of this insulation separation. So ultimately, this capacity coupling will present a low impedance at high frequency because of 1/2 πfc. So you can't provide a panel isolated from the bears or the associated nearby earthing metal parts. It's a must why equipotential bonding is insisted in the regulations. Another hazardous thing, nowadays we are all having fiber optic cable for internet connections and TVs, etc., and dish antennas. But still, there exists some cable TV. Some cable TV, it's a dangerous thing. You will be having a modem or your own device in your home. And the cable TV, it will be located some distance away from your home, where a charged cloud can pass, which can reflect or induce a voltage in your system, destroying your system. Not only your system, if anybody, some meddling with the TV, cable wire, everything, it is really a danger. So be careful while handling with the cable from cable TV operators, and ensure there are blocking condensers there. Then what should be the value for a human body regarding the time bar current effect of AC current on a human body? The worst part is between left hand to feet. This worst part, what the international IEC has devised is, the first zone, this is up to 0.5, the SRC is milliamps, up to 0.5 milliamps, you can have any equipment design, but it is very difficult to design any equipment at this major because any equipment is associated with the metallic part winding and capacity as well as inductive coupling. So it is very tough to design a system in commercial and practical use. Next, we have a practical approach. This is a zone 2. Here you can devise. Suppose the human can withstand 100 milliamps for a duration of about 60 milliseconds. If it is 50 milliamps, he can withstand for a duration of 200 milliseconds. Beyond which, there will be some pulmonary, that is some breathing trouble will occur. But this zone is can be retrieved. He can be given some CPR technique and the person affected can be retrieved. So this is also a zone which a person can be retrieved and brought back to normalcy. And beyond this, suppose if the electro current exceeds 500 milliamps and the duration is more than instantly, if above 500 milliamps means, or above 100 milliamps or above 500 milliseconds means, you will be directly entering into the zone of ventricular fibrillation. So it's the basis how the personal safety is being addressed in designing an earthing installation. So this is the provision as per CEA regulation to provide an earth leakage protective device. We can't say this as earth leakage circuit breaker or RCBO or core balanced CT depending upon the load that you have connected to your installation. If it is a small installation or single phase service, it is sufficient to have ELCV. And if it is an LT installation of small premises of less than 100 kilowatt to 112.5 kilowatt, then you should have some core balance CT. If it is a small dwelling house, you can have a RCBO. So the final the purpose is to have protection for the leakage current. And this is a TNS earthing system. You can see in the at the source, the neutral is earth to the ground through the earth electrode. And the consumer equipment is also provided with a separate protective earthing conductor, where this protective earthing conductor is connected to all the metallic part of various equipments. Then it is in turn connected to the metal frame. So if there is a fault, then it will flow through this to the source. Thereby, our protective device, if any, will have a sufficient amount of fault current to clear the fault. So in the TNS system, this is the criteria featured in IS 3043. The fault loop impedance multiplied by the current ensuring operation of the disconnecting device should always be less than the conventional voltage. The conventional voltage limit is nothing but 240 volts multiplied by 0.95 factor. Ultimately you have to ensure the conductor resistance. You have to depend on the conductor resistance alone to achieve this, because it will be very minimal. The fault loop impedance should be very minimal. The voltage will be, say, 240 into 0.95, say 200. And if you have a current, fault current of 6 kilo ohms, you can see, say 1 kilo ohm also, you can see how much of impedance. It will be in the order of less than 0.5 ohm, 0.1 ohm even, for small house. So it can be governed by the correct selection of the conductors, the line conductors as well as the protective earthing conductor. That's why the code provides up to 16 square mm. The minimum cross-sectional area of the protective conductor should be the size of the face conductor. Beyond up to 35, it should be not less than 16 square mm. Suppose if you have at any case, the protective conductor size should not be less than 2.5 square mm. This is a minimum size. If it mechanical protection is not provided, then it can be 4 square mm. So this is a minimum size that you have to ensure as per ISO. Another thing we have to ensure is the fault current, the earthing, the conductor, the protective earthing conductor itself should not succumb to the fault current. It should not melt away, giving fault. There's no path for the fault current. So you have to ensure what should be the minimum size of the protective conductor whenever the conductor size is 35 square. This is the formula. And for any cross-sectional area, the cross-sectional area is governed by the fault current multiplied by the square root of t. So in other words, we can say k square s square is equal to I square t. So we have to know the k factor. The k factor varies with the type of material. Some place you can provide PVC lead in home, or some SLP in industry, or some steel bare wire. So depending upon this, the factor varies. And you have to see that this cross-sectional area should be chosen in such a way that it is not less than this for cables exceeding 35 square amount. A typical value, for example, if you use a 10 SLF with the copper conductor, see, it is equivalent to 8 square mm, and the value of fault current, it can withstand for 1 second. For 1 second, it can withstand just 1129 amps. If it is GA, it is 400 amps only. It is based on the formula given in the above slide. And so these are the important factors that you have to consider. First of all, you observe clearance from the OS line of the distribution company. Then also you see whether approval of local body or pollution control board in specific LT installations where some special norms are faced. And engaging a licensed contractor, method of wiring, distribution arrangement, and some emergency mine. These are the factors that the contractor should know while erecting and installing the premises. And the selection of cable that we have already explained, selection of circuit protection device, and coordination between cable, load, and circuit protection device, installation of earthing and conductor sizing also important. And more importantly, testing of insulation resistance, earth loop impedance, and earth leakage, earth resistance, as well as the periodical maintenance. So these are the things that the owner, in spite of, we can't expect a owner to know all the technical parameters. These checkpoints can make a relief to the owner whether he is safe at the hands of various regulations. Now I am coming to the sensitive. We have to deal with the sensitive components also of electronic devices so that they are not affected during the noise earthing. So what I want to say is, suppose if there is a multiple earthing, the needle is earthed here. If we, by mistake, if a person earth the needle at some other point, then circulating current, instead of the current normally have to flow there, if there is a multiple earthing, the circulating current will also flow. So this circulating current will create a voltage between the neutral and the metallic part of the equipment, to which the especially the sensitive components are referenced. This reference voltage will be affected. So we have to avoid circulating current. These are the mitigations for the low frequency earthing noise. So for the UPS insulation, we should know what are the factors that we should adhere in making the UPS, because there are several confusions among the electrician and the people as well as the engineers, where we have to connect the neutral with the earth, where we should not. The purpose of UPS supply to IT equipment is integrity of neutral. integrity of neutral means at any point neutral should not be disconnected momentary, any momentary neutral disconnection should not be there, that will affect the load naturally. So this can be avoided by make before break of neutral contactor, neutral contact ATS or something. Because we do not have the IT equipments alone in premises, we do have some other major loads, say HVAC equipments and a transformer source, a generator source, which are all interlocked. Then comes your UPS device, where you can have an isolation transformer. So these are the things that may make a neutral integrity, a harm to the neutral integrity. So you have to ensure neutral integrity of your UPS supply. And if there is any wrong connection, any multiple earthing, this may trip the upstream earth leakage protection devices also. This will affect some other more critical load, for example, fire service circuit, some emergency lighting circuit. Those ELCBs should not be tripped by means of wrong or multiple connection or electrical noises in the IT equipment, downstream sites. And single point source is always necessary for easy referencing. But it is it is easy to provide a separate circuit right from the main panel so as to avoid noise from other circuits. If you provide a source conductor as well as the earthing conductor from the same point of breaker or fault clearing device, then the referencing will be easy, noise from other circuit will not happen. And harmful voltage sag, for example, if your motor start in your UPS circuit, which is feeding another big motor, some sag will also be there. So it is essential to provide a single point source for easy referencing as well as the safe operation of UPS devices. And there lies an inherent difficulty in providing a single point source, because a single point source is not sufficient, because in major data center, you will be having, you should have some different source of supply. Source of supply from the transformer, source of supply from generator, and another source of supply from some other generator. So it will be multiple different source of supply. Ultimately, different source of circuit may also be warranted. It is inevitable. So how to mitigate those things also will be addressed here. Here, the first thing is efficient local TNS system. We are having a TNS system at the entry point. That is, whether it's a transformer or generator, we have a TNS system. But if we avail so many circuits to make the architecture in order to improve the overall system reliability, then you should use isolation transformer. Here comes the isolation transformer. So economy and performance based on the sensitiveness of the load is always there. We can't insist isolation transformer at the bypass circuit, at the incomer, outgoing, etc., etc., for small shock. But it may be necessary for complex major data centers. So noise voltage mitigation, low frequency is somewhat easier to manage, because we can easily mitigate those things by avoiding these simple points. So first, avoid multiple earthing at the source neutral. Then adapt single point earthing. Avoid isolated earth electrode. People nowadays provide isolated earth electrode. It's a misnomer. You can't provide any isolated earth electrode, dedicated earth electrode. These are all coming fashionable in IT industry. I will say in another slide how it is wrong. So we should ensure effective on TNS, localized TNS earthing system to avoid galvanic connection, because the galvanic connection from the source, from the metal body of other equipments with the IT devices or sensitive devices only bring the unwanted neutral to earth potential rise also. So use of isolation transformer is very much important in such areas. And the insulated earthing conductor, But this insulator earthing conductor may not be desirable in certain cases also. So it's a simple way of mitigating lightning protection in any small LT insulation premises is forming a ring conductor of 75 to 150 square mm size GI conductor buried to the ground around the building and interconnector with the earth electrodes for lightning protection. So you should always remember the mandatory requirement of supplementary bonding, that is earth potential rise due to lightning and surge. I am repeating this again and again because this is missing in most of the insulation. The frame of UPS earth, because people do not connect the frame with the equipotential bonding. That's why it is mandatory in spite of all the other type of earthing or mitigations. The body earth connection of various equipment should be interconnected to an earth bus, which in turn should be brought up to the neutral earth flat of the source and connected at a single point of raw power source earthing. See, this is a sample picture that there are a lot of configurations depending upon the utilization. We can have several configurations. Simple configuration is to provide, for example, if you have a neutral, for example, a star connector neutral. See, this neutral is connected to the body at the source only. Then this neutral will come up to this point. Here, this is the neutral of the UPS. Here, this neutral will not be connected to the ground. This will be connected to the neutral. So this is a single point. So reference will be at the only one point only. So this is a must why we provide a neutral for small insulations at the single point. Here, you should not connect. Here, you should not connect the neutral with the body. And you should have your system immune to the adjoining earth noises. So what we can suggest is a power distribution center nearer to the computer loads. Here you are providing a delta and star connected transformer, which will have its own neutral to ground earth electrode. This neutral to ground earth electrode connection, this is the important bonding connection. This makes the TNS system. All the downstream equipments from this TNS system will always be referenced to this area only. So you are minimizing the noises from all other sources here, here. You are minimizing. Your noise is restricted to this area. All your downstream computer loads will be referenced to this common grid. Of course, you see these, all these ground terminals will always run to the source. This is the equipotential body. And you can see the manufacturer's guidelines also. So most of the manufacturer's
guidelines. Respected sir, already 5:55. Kindly finish in next 5 minutes, please.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. So this is the manufacturer's guideline. You can see this is a UPS. They have provided a manufacturer isolation transformer, sketch of isolation transformer. You can see the isolation transformer neutral is not connected to the frame or the core of the transformer. It is isolated. Here this is the UPS and this is the load. Here they have shown in one of the leading manufacturer isolation brochure I have seen, they have shown the neutral of source, that is the UPS is connected to the earth and earth layer. This is the isolation transformer. Here it is not earthed. You can't have an unearthed system at the downstream. Actually, this should be here. If you see the previous slide, then you will be enlightened. I have also seen some local manufacturer transformer also. These are the warning they have provided. In the local manufacturer's pamphlet also, you can see if the input bar output power of UPS is star star Y connection, then neutral and ground should not be connected. Again, this is where we can't go as per the manufacturer's guidelines, and we should analyze whether it is right or wrong for which only we require the knowledge of separately derived resources as shown in the previous slide. So the insulated earth layer, it is applicable for some devices which are unearthed, which are very closer to the source. Here you can have some insulated earth layer which is very close by to the source, so that low frequency noise can be mitigated. Another area of concern is this is high frequency. In this high frequency, you have a chance of interfacing two equipments. The equipment A and equipment B are interfaced by a signal conductor. If your earth electrode at B is not interconnected with the earth electrode at A, then you will be having a circulating current loop, which is dangerous for the sensitive equipments. Then, see, for this building also there is some problem. In the building, you will be having, you should not have a system with uninterconnected earth electrode. For building earth electrode is separate, and your lightning earth electrode is, and your equipment earth electrode is separate. This is not correct. And there is some other small system where you can have, see, for example, two equipments are connected from different sources. One equipment here, one equipment here. These two things are interconnected by communication cable. See, simple solution is you can disconnect. And if you connect from the same source of power source as well as anything, so the circulating current will not be there. Here, this is the circulating current through the communication cable. Here, the circulating current is eliminated because of the common power source. And another small, at a high frequency, this is very important. There are really high frequency noise sources are caused due to real and parasitic inductive capacitance. How to avoid? We have to mitigate. It comes from VFD drives, lightning cells, switching cells, and ESDM processor. So we have to address the earthing design for the high frequency, and we have to take into account of the traveling wave also. At high frequency, for normal frequency, you can see that the conductor length, all power frequency voltage transmission lines are short lines, because the 1/4 of this is the wave propagation theory suggests that wavelength is governed by this formula. And if your line length is more than 990 kilometer, then it will be a long line. It is not practically possible. So whenever the high frequency currents are coming into picture, say a switching surge or a lightning surge air per 20 microseconds, which is equivalent to a 50 kilohertz frequency source, where your conductor length should not go beyond 990. Same applies if you have a radio frequency equipment, then your conductor length should be restricted to less than 0.5 meter. So conventional power system earthing requires modification when frequency is high, especially the earth leads length should be restricted depending upon the frequency of interest. Then mitigation of noise voltage. Best solution is fiber optic cable, immunity from all type. Separation of panels away from the VFD drive and other EMI causing sources. And cable trays are very important, metallic cable tray. And parallel unscreened power cable should not be there if the length exceeds as per IEC. If it exceeds 35, you should use a screened cable, or separation should also be there. For ESD mitigation, at very high frequency, you can see that normally EMI mitigation is possible with magnetic materials, say GA. But at a very high frequency, you can use some paramagnetic material also. For example, aluminum or copper foils will play a very good impact, contrary to the belief, because of low permeability of material at high frequency. So at high frequency, you can provide screening using copper or aluminium. Shielding to absorb or reflect EMI radio frequencies achieved by metallic cover and the cable. And signal reference grounding is also used nowadays for critical areas where lot of high frequency sensitive devices are used. It is nothing but providing a strap. We can place the equipment on a false flooring with meshed grid, and your equipment can be connected to the earth grid using strap. This is a flat copper flat. This flat, why the length is restricted, the width is increased, because the to reduce the inductive effect. The inductive effect at very high frequency, it is nearly open circuited, so we have to increase the length. We can't increase the length to certain limit, but we can increase the width. So length width ratio is important in providing these things. So single reference grounding, if you don't have isolation transformer, optic fiber, etc., then SRG, a special method. Suppose if you don't have isolation transformer or optic fiber, and there is no physically separated devices, then you have to go for single reference grounding. If you have these things, then single reference grounding is not required. So in SRP, the single reference plane, the entire perimeter base shall be welded to the base metallic part, but it is not possible. That's why we are using flat aisle strips. So straps of minimum length suitable for the frequency under consideration. If your frequency is 100 megahertz, use a strap of less than 0.5 meter. But SRG, that is single reference grounding, is not suitable for equipment located at different areas of the building because of the length. Use SPD, optical isolator, or capacitor at one end to shield the or to block the low frequency from the high frequency. This is a typical arrangement in single reference grid arrangement, where these are the IT devices. They are connected to the nearby DN earthing system through the small strap. These straps are connected to the grid, and these are the this is a safety equipment ground conductor. Everything goes to the same source. Within this grid, the high frequency straps are getting equipotential. This is an equipotential plan where you can mitigate effectively the high frequency current in IT system. So to conclude, I would like to say that assess the effectiveness of TNS earth connection, because TNS earth connection will not always be effective in a very big or geographical area of very big insulation beyond 500 meter or 300 meter. For small shop of 10 meter by 10 meter, it's okay. For long long system, you can use a local transformer, isolation transformer. Identify situation of power frequency. So depending upon the high frequency, you can go for the various type of mitigation. And a single point earthing connection. So these are the mitigation required according to your area of interest. If you have high frequency, if you have a low frequency, then you can go for a single point earthing connection. And a single reference plane also for high frequency. Then screening, separation, and size diversion are important factors for EMI interference. Then adhere to the mandatory equipotential bounding for protection of person and property. So with this, I would like to thank all the participants for your patient hearing. I couldn't cover all the detailed aspects. However, I am ready to invite questions from you. And thank you, everybody. Mr. Rajesh ji, it's over to you, please.
Thank you very much for such a enlightening and wonderful session. In short, it was mind-blowing, and I bow my head down. You are really a wonderful speaker, knowledgeable person, and we will have to learn many things. Still, we have to learn many things from you. And I am going to give brief of your presentation. You talked, you touched upon about clearances, insulation, insulated conductor, factor influencing the safe installations. You talked about IC 60364, typical curve for MCB, maximum cables that can be in a single conduit purpose of earthing, CA regulation 41, the importance of cable, TV cables, how it can be dangerous, effect of current on body, what is CP, core balance CT, CBCT, for loop impedance, you touch upon the size of earthing conductor required, LT installation. You talked about importance of multiple neutral earthing, requirement of UPS installation, separately drive system you touched upon in a very wonderful manner, in a very enlightening manner, and how to avoid isolated earthing you described in a very good fashion. And you described the importance of isolation transformer in our systems. You touched upon everything about screening cables, how to do earthing of that, how to go for the high frequency noise analysis you covered upon. Thank you very much. And I have seen screen. There are three questions, and these are from three persons. And I would like to invite one by one all three persons to come out with their questions so that Appau sir can answer that one. First of all, I would like to invite Mr. Sarang. His question related to equipotential bonding. Please unmute Mr. Sarang and ask your question.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Really wonderful session.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for such a sir, for equipotential or flammable material storage, will it be hazardous to connect to our existing earthing system, or body earthing for these hazardous metals shall be separate?
What is your actual activity? Your interest, is it inflammable area or normal factory premises? What is the area of activity?
For any kind of hazardous metal storage inside the plant.
No, because inflammable, for inflammable, we are not covering inflammable, where suppose if there is some inflammable liquid, there flash point could be some, we can't take a risk there. There are separate standards for that from oil companies they have. So I want to know whether if my coverage is for the normal LT installations and the sensitive devices. If it is in, it falls under the scope of hazardous materials, please tell me the actual thing that whether I can address.
Mr. Sarang, you can do one thing. You can write an email to us, and with complete question you have in your mind, we will answer you shortly.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. And now I would like to invite Mr. Rohit Pathak. He has some queries to make. Rohitji, please.
Good evening, sir, and thank you for so much informative session today. As my question is that, sir, is it okay that to earth screen cable from both ends? Because in plants we usually see customer will only earth cable from one end, from one side only, to avoid EMC or electromagnetic compatibility or through the system or some interferences. So according to any standard that justified to earth the cable from both ends, or only one end is mandatory?
Okay, see this slide. I think, do you see the slide, the screen?
Yes,
we can see, sir.
Yes, I think this will help you understand. See, the screen earth is generally manufacturer advised screen earth at one end to take care of the ampacity, that is ampere rating. You can leave other end, but the problem is, in as far as EMC concerns are coming into picture, you can't leave, because see the first picture here, this is earthed at one end. In another end, it is see, there is a voltage limiter. It's something like circulating current can induce a voltage which can be detrimental, which can make a hazard to the worker at the say load end. This is a source end. If you treat this is a source and this is a load, and there will be a potential difference between the if you leave it unearthed, and there is a likelihood of person being get a shock here. This is for the normal operating person. Suppose if there are other measures, midpoint earthing is also there. Midpoint earthing is also there, and there is one more method of transposing. These are all derived important for the cable which are laid. For example, there are some cable which are laid directly beneath the are adjacent to the EHT OHS layer. In those circumstances, you have to observe these three things according to the value of voltage induced. But it should be earthed at both ends, and if it is left, it is preferable to have it earthed at the other end, that is the load end, with a surge diverter device to take care of the raised potential drained to the earthed part, because this raised potential should always be discharged to the earthed part to avoid harm to that person.
Thank you. Well understood. Okay, now I would like to invite Mr. Vinod. Vinodji, please come up and ask you a question. It is about how to protect fiber optics modem from electromagnetic interference. Am I right? I think he's not there. Please answer.
Okay. See, fiber optic cable itself is immune. It is light to signal. Only the cumbersome process of terminations will be there. To avoid, this is one shot, you can avoid electromagnetic interference in a fiber optic cable. But there are some cases where fiber optic cables are strung through the metallic conductor and terminated at your home for internet connections. There you have to take care of fiber. Fiber optic cable by itself is it's a very good, the best arrangement. But if it is for mechanical purpose, it may be brought to your home using some bearer conductor of metallic. There you have to take care.
Now the next
fiber optic is immune to EMI. That's what, to my knowledge.
Now the last but not the least question of our session is by Barun. Barunji, please come and ask you a question.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, my question is regarding the earthing of a substation. Here we have a ST-LT panel and outdoor oil field transformer. Sir, how many earthing pit shall we provide for this system?
It is the very valid question. It will take 3 hours to explain. I am having one session tomorrow exclusively to address what should be the earth resistance value. For the earth resistance value, how many earth electrodes should be provided? What should be the number of flat electrodes or rod electrodes? What is the soil resistivity? What is the fault current? It is not a single thing. What should be the earth resistance? It can be 1 ohm, 5 ohm, 50 ohm. Rajesh ji will explain with reference to that.
Yes, Barun ji.
It varies, but we should know it is not a separate entity. It is related to the safe operation of the fault clearing device, soil resistivity, so many factors. Unless we correlate all these factors, we can't say by thumb rule how many electrodes. For example, a 3 meter long GI pipe in a soil resistivity of 10 ohm meter will yield a 5 ohm. If it is placed in a rocky soil with a soil resistivity of 1000 ohm meter, it may yield a 200 ohms. Can I say that you provide 20 earth electrodes? We should know the soil also. I think you better attend the tomorrow's webinar that we are addressing for ST installations. Rajesh will elaborate for EHV substation is a separate thing.
I will be sharing the link for that seminar also in the group.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Before I complete my session, Anjali Chandra ma'am, respected Anjali Chandra ma'am, is available. I would like to invite ma'am, please come out and say a few words before we finish our session today.
Hello, good evening, everyone. It was a very fascinating session. I think Mr. Apurva has a vast knowledge and we gained a lot. Rajesh, can you share the PPT for everyone?
Yes, it will be available on the group very soon.
Yeah, because, you know, I missed some part of it in the beginning, but whatever I heard was very very knowledgeable for me also. I learned a lot. And Mr. Apurva, I would really congratulate you on explaining it so well. Thank you so much. And thank you Rajesh, ma'am, for getting this.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Your words matter.
Thank you, ma'am.
It gives us energy.
I have been hearing it. You know, I started all this that we should have TNS and...
Yes. I was noticing. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for joining our group as well as joining today's session. Thankful to you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And now I would like to invite Vikas ji, please say a few words before we finish our session. We are already late by 5 minutes.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Rajesh ji. Wonderful session by Apavu sir. And all the seniors who are attending here, including Anjali Chandra ma'am, KK Murthy sahab, everyone here, basically, you know, thank you very much for attending. Maybe, you know, give me opportunity to ask one last question to Apavu sir, basically, because I don't want to sleep with that question. Apavu sir, regarding UPS, it provides differential mode protection. But what about the common mode protection? Because the earth is same, you know, input and output. So there would not be any protection on the common mode on UPS.
No, I'm unable to follow. What's that? UPS system?
The UPS, uninterruptible power supply.
Okay.
The earth is same. Input and output earth is same, right? Mm-hmm. So your whatever will flow on the earth, it will appear on the other side also. Like if the lightning is there.
No, sir. No, you see. In order to correctly understand the UPS configuration, we should go through IEEE 1100 and IEEE 142. In short, what I can say is a separately derived system. We have to coin a word, separately derived system, which means a system which by itself is galvanically, it is not electrically or metallically connected to the other source. For example, a DG driven system, diesel generator is a separately derived. A transformer is a separately derived. For example, if these two things are connected, whether the neutral or the metal body, then they are non-separately. A general rule, a separately derived source, that is, whether it is isolation transformer or UPS, the galvanic connection is not there. But you have a secondary supply independent from this source. That is a separately derived source. From this independent supply point, you have an earthed system. You make an earth, that is the neutral with the body at the starting point. Here comes the TNS system. You understand, this is a TNS system. So here we galvanically isolate. So coming to your point, you are saying that equipotential bonding will be linking the thing. It will not flow. Equipotential bonding will be giving a helping hand for your extraneous voltages or electrostatic discharge only. This will not affect your UPS system because they are already isolated from your system. Depending upon the noise, we can provide isolation. If the noise is tolerable, if it is not a server or home, if it is a home computer or small shop only, you need not provide an isolation transformer. If it is a server, you have to provide. If it is still high frequency equipment, you have to use all the means and fiber optic cable also. So we can easily isolate the supply. The purpose is not to isolate. You isolate if you require, depending upon the quantum of low frequency noise as well as the high frequency noise, according to the methodologies shown in these slides.
Right, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Okay. So thank you very much, Apoorva sir, for accepting our invitation. Thank you very much to all the participants, Dr. Arora, for organizing this so wonderfully today. And this was a short session. Of course, 1 hour is not sufficient for such a great subject of earthing, and everybody needs to know more and more about this, actually. Every time I attend a seminar, there is something new to learn. And I would say, basically, you know, all of us should contribute in the knowledge here, because ultimately it is for the safety of the people. So thank you very much, Dr. Arora. Thanks for...
Thank you, everyone. You know, basically, we have taken very first step towards the journey of 1,000 miles. Thank you very much for being part of this journey, and we hope we will going to fulfill our objective by your support. Thank you once again, everyone.
Thank you, thank you once again. Bye. Bye, sir. Bye.
Thank you once again. Bye.